Good singing. Paul the Apostle has barely finished introducing himself in the opening lines of his letter that we call Ephesians, that he jumps into praising God. Now as we begin reading in verse 15, you'll see his praise turn to prayer, and that is fitting. Let's read, starting in verse 15. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. One of the reasons this letter is seen by many to be a circular letter intended to be read by several different churches in that Asia area, not just Ephesus, is these verses here. If you know Paul's history, you know he spent some considerable time in Ephesus, at one point over 2 years, and maybe some would suggest up to 3.5 for his going in and out teaching and preaching. So if he spent that much time with them, then this is odd that he doesn't already know these people intimately. Whoever the audience was, though, Paul loved what he was hearing. He heard about them. Their reputation preceded them. Of all the things Paul didn't know, maybe couldn't know, two things he knew for sure: they had great faith in God, and they loved all of God's people. Their love and their faith, that was inspiring, and Paul compliments them, pats them on the back for that. In these 13 years that I've been a minister here at Brookline, I've had the pleasure of knowing some of you at your highest and your lowest. I look around at faces, and they're not just faces, they're friends, your family. I have watched as some of you welcome precious babies into your lives. I have stood with some of you as you united yourselves as husband and wife to each other. I have celebrated with some of you when big things happen and joyous moments came your way. I had the honor of watching some of you immersed into Christ. Sometimes I was in the water with you. Sadly, I have sat with some of you when words didn't do much good, when some of you were lying in a hospital bed because of sickness and disease. I've tried to encourage some of you and just pray for you if jobs were lost or deep hurts were felt or marriages failed. And I have stood by some of you and cried right with you when you struggled to get through the moment as your loved one dies and is buried. And I consider myself rich too, like Paul. I know I am rich because of the time I've spent with you. In the good and the bad, I've watched your faith. And I have looked out to see some of you standing here as you're sitting there. And I have remembered some of your stories of excruciating pain. And to see you here, still in church, still in Christ, still singing praise through all of it, holding on to your faith in Him, it's inspired me. And I've been loved by you, my family's been treated well by you, and I'm constantly inspired by the way you love. So thank you for your love for me, for us, for each other. Keep that up. Always keep that up, because love must be our calling card. It's what sets us apart, our faith and our love. So like Paul, I'm grateful for you. I thank God for you. I can't stop thanking God for the good people in this church. And when I and my family are somewhere else on another Sunday morning, when we're also around some really good people in a really good church filled with really good people of faith, usually, inevitably, one of us in our family will still say on that Sunday morning, I miss Brookline. I know we have problems here. We probably always will have some problems. We might as well fess up to that. We might have times where we sometimes lose faith in each other. We have a hard time when we wrestle with some things. But I would rather be here with you than anywhere else, sharing this experience called faith and family and church together, because I think that's the way it's supposed to be. Paul goes on and thanks God for them and then asks God to help them. This verse, 17, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know Him better. Paul wants them to be blessed with the Spirit. Now, they've already been blessed with the Spirit, but he wants them to be blessed even more by that same Spirit, more of Him in you. The one who gives revelation, the one who gives knowledge, the one who gives wisdom, he wants them to know more, really to know better and to know deeper, to know truer. It's more than information, even though I'm sure it's some information, but it's more of it. It's what the Spirit can easily provide if you allow Him. And it's not so much on this intellectual level, but this deep down internal level, this relational level. I've said this before, I suppose if my dad had written books, or if books had been written about my dad, neither one is true, but you could have read them very well and probably known some things about my dad I didn't even know. It's been said by many, though, that knowing about someone is not the same as knowing someone. I knew my father, and I wish you could have too. Paul is not asking that the Spirit of God was shared with them only information for the head, so that they could just know something more about God. It's bigger than that. It's deeper than that. He wants the Spirit to help them to come to know the Father better, more intimately. And I think you know what that means. In the Hebrew language, when someone was intimate with another, like between a man and a woman sexually, like when Adam, it says, knew his wife Eve, it's that he really knew her. That's on a different level than I read something. Now, please don't think sexually here with Paul's language. Think intimately, like when you really, really know a good friend because you spent so much time around him, or you've shared something very deeply personal with her. That's the point here. I suspect anyone in this audience could say at some level, we know something about God. There could be an atheist here who would say, I know something about God. But many in this church would say it's more than that. We have come to know God. And Paul's prayer is accurate, even for those who already could say, I know God. It's the prayer is that they would come to know Him better. That we would come to know Him better. Paul's not done praying for more for them. Keep going. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which He has called you, the riches of His glorious inheritance in His holy people, and His incomparably great power for us who believe. You almost have to digest that to really see what a beautiful prayer that is. Paul is praying intently that the eyes of their heart, not the eyes in their head, what is inside would be so enlightened that they could see or know or comprehend or understand the hope to which they were called. Hope, what they were created to be, what they have been called and chosen and predestined to become, what they have in their future and will grow up into to take hold of soon. Back in 2006, NBC reported on these three fishermen off of Mexico's coast who were lost at sea for 9 months, drifting aimlessly on this broken down boat. And they survived by fishing with a fishing rod constructed out of broken engine parts and this bucket where they collected rainwater. And they ate raw fish and raw ducks and raw seagulls. Anything that landed on their boat, they grabbed it and they ate it raw. They barely made it, but they made it. They survived until they were finally rescued by a Taiwanese fishing boat, and it happened to be about 5,000 miles from where they first started their fishing journey. One of the survivors said this, "We never lost hope because there is a God up there." And he described how they took turns reading from one of their last remaining possessions, a battered Bible, which had only a few worn pages left at the end of their journey. Hope. It is what sustains us. And the biblical idea of hope is more than a wish. It's not a Christmas fanciful dream of I'd like to, just don't know if I'm getting it, hope. It's a confidence in the God who promises, is faithful, and always fulfills his promises every single time. And Paul also prays that they could know the riches of his glory and glorious inheritance in his holy people. What he is in us, what he has done through us, what he has prepared for us, what we are, what we have, and what we will inherit someday. All of it, it's all yours, it's all ours, all of it. The Telegraph had an article by a writer in Tokyo. This is November of 2013. It's kind of a sad story because it's about this Japanese man who was born to wealthy parents in this hospital but grew up instead in poverty because at the hospital he was given to another couple who'd also had a baby. The babies were swapped accidentally. And this family that he ended up with was not very well off. So now this 60-year-old man, 60, finds out, as his name, doesn't want his name released, but he finds out he's grown up on handouts from the state while really he should have been wealthy. The man he always figured was dad died when he was 2. The woman he called mother supported him and his 3 older brothers, had very few comforts, lived in their 1-bedroom apartment, went to night school while working day shifts at the factory before finally finding somewhat better employment as a driver with a transport company. But he never married, and at the end of his life was actually taking care of his brothers. The boy that was switched at birth with him, who was really born into poverty, ended up living in the palace, it seemed like. Relative affluence. That boy had a personal tutor, went to university, and now was the head of the successful real estate company that everybody knew. So it was back in 2011 when the mistake was discovered, that the records at the hospital were pulled out, they were checked, the DNA tests were ordered, and sure enough, it came back. They discovered that a midwife took the 2 boys together to be bathed and returned them and accidentally gave them to the wrong mothers. Imagine the shock when the families discovered the truth. That man successfully sued the hospital and got some money out of it, but how do you get back your identity? How do you get back years? How do you get back memories? How do you get back riches that should have been his whole life? He never got to enjoy it. You can't undo that. There's a little good news, I guess, that this man's biological brothers, living very well, did want a relationship with him. But the sad part is his biological parents died before any of them learned the truth of this. And he said, as he thought about all this, I might have had a different life. Yeah, I want the hospital to roll back the clock to the day I was born. Wouldn't that be sad to discover late in life that you were actually rich, born into an influential family, had all you could ever need in life, except that you didn't know it for all those years and didn't learn it till you're 60, but grew up in relative poverty? How sad do you think it is for a Christian who has been born again, born to royalty, with all of the riches of heaven, blessed in every spiritual way in Christ, to discover way too late that he or she was that, should have been that, a somebody, a creation of God, redeemed, adopted, called, promised an inheritance of everything, but sadly has been living a sad life, feeling as if there is nothing and they are a nobody. Do you know how rich you are today? Paul prays also that they would know his incomparably great power for those of us who believe. Power. Now, the charismatic churches speak a lot about power, and sometimes I wonder why that word has in some ways disappeared from our language. Maybe because we hear what some say and what some believe and what some claim. But the truth is, we do have power. Great power, incomparably great power. And just so you know, I sadly can't raise the dead. I can't lay my hands on anybody and cure any disease, although I wish I could. You probably wish too. But we have been given great power. Everyone who has believed in God, everybody who has been born again with Christ, given the Spirit of God, has great power. How great is that power, you might ask? Glad you asked. Let Paul answer it. Listen. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked not only in the present age but also in the one to come. That is an astounding claim. And I just wonder if you believe it. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead, the same power that sat the risen Lord on the eternal throne, the same power that gave him the rule and authority over every rule and authority, the same power that gave him both power and dominion over every power and dominion, the same power that gave him the name above every name that has ever been invoked in the past or ever will be in the future, that power, listen carefully, that power has been given to you who believe in him. Now, some may want that power to prove something. No need. It's already been proven. Some may want that power to make a name for themselves, but that would be a great misuse of that power. And some may want that power to do things, miraculous things, that could solve every problem and cure every disease and heal every person. I figure we would all want that for the good of others. But God hasn't given us that kind of power to do that kind of thing, and I'm certain he can answer that question someday, even if I can't right now. But he has given us great power, and as you might be surprised, Paul says that you have that power to do great things, and he will tell you, like in chapter 3 and in chapter 6, but you'll just have to wait till we get there. You'll just have to wait. But we who believe in Jesus have power, and that may sound strange because sometimes Christians feel powerless. I've seen us as things fall apart and we watch the news and we worry about politics and we fear the future of this country, the future of the world, the future of the church. And we wonder what is happening and we feel doomed and hopeless and helpless. But saints, that is not true. We have great power to do great things, and if you'll hang with Paul and keep reading, you'll learn more about that power. But keep reading here for now. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Funny how everything keeps coming back to Jesus. The Christ is the answer before we ever ask a question. God made Jesus Lord over everything. He placed him above everything and everyone, and he put him in this world and put him on the cross and put him in the grave and brought him out of the grave and took him up unto himself and put him where he should be and always be, will be forevermore, on the throne, reigning supremely over all. And everything, and I mean everything, is now or someday will be under his feet. And we might be bothered or worried about some people today, this authority or that government, some power or some dictator, some murderer or some persecutor or some threat. But trust me, trust the scripture, trust Paul, that these will not stand for long. The innocent ones and the Christian saints may be haunted through history, persecuted at times, even killed by some of these maniacs in power. But these godless figures in history and sometimes in current countries cannot stand much longer. Because anyone who stands up against God will be humbled and every knee someday will bow. And it will be really ironic for those who have believed they ruled the world to one day meet the one who actually rules the universe. It'll be a humbling day for some. And while we as the church wait for that day to come where the sovereign Lord and ruler of all will be head over everything and make everything right, this is not the time to be passive, as Paul will go on to say. And maybe we say, but Jesus isn't here, but he is. Oh, technically he's there, but he's here. Spiritually, relationally, representatively, he is here. Still today, filling everything in every way, because he is filling it all up. And you may say, but how can he do that? And Paul answers it, in the church. Jesus is the head of the church. The church is his body on earth. He rules, and even if some don't understand and will not submit, the hope of the world is the church, his representative on earth. And we who are in Christ, in the church, we submit and we trust and we fight the battle for men's souls. We share the good news every chance we can, and we wait for the day when he comes again and makes all things right. And until that day, we will be faithful, and we will keep loving the saints. Now, that's what Paul commends the saints for. They kept their faith in God. They kept loving God's people. And if we today will be the church of Christ, then we will do that too. What do I want for you? Well, if you have never bowed your knee to God, never put your faith in Christ, never been united with him in baptism, never received the gift of the Spirit, the gift of forgiveness, that's what I want for you today. But since you are, most of you are already in Christ, what do I hope for you today? Could I steal Paul's words? I pray that God will give you, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, and that you, church, would come to know him better. That the eyes of your heart would be enlightened so that you could actually see, really, truly see, fully know the hope to which you were called, the riches of his glorious inheritance and his incomparably great power for all of you who do believe. In August 2015, Joshua Rothman wrote this article for the New Yorker. It was called Seeing and Hearing for the First Time on YouTube. And he talks about some videos that I've seen. Maybe you have too. There was Ethan Scott, who was colorblind his whole life. And then he got those Enchroma glasses and put them on and couldn't believe what he saw. He walks around his open office there and he sees some post-it notes and some highlighters that are bright, and he gawks at the colors. He holds a package of disinfectant wipes in his hand and he asks, "Is this purple?" He steps outside, kneels down to touch the grass and says, It's so beautiful." There's Opie Hughes, a father of two, puts on those same glasses for the first time, and his sister encourages him, "Look at your kid's eyes, look at your kid's eyes." And he looks at his son's blue eyes, and he sits on his front stoop just speechless. You can see these and plenty of other videos where people see for the first time or see color for the first time, and some of these people just cry. They just cry. Well, the writer of the article adds his own story, not about color blindness, but two other eye issues that made it a very blurry world for him where everything looked vague. He said it was like walking underwater. That is, until he was given this new prescription by this doctor, this new set of contacts that really did change everything. And this is what he wrote. "I saw things that I'd never seen before. Streets grew longer, and for the first time I saw the horizon. The three-dimensionality of buildings astonished me. Their newly visible interiors made them look like open jewelry boxes. Giving a lecture, I suddenly saw the faces of my students, and I found their beauty arresting. For the first time, I saw the special facial expressions of old friends. On the subway, I grew so absorbed by the eye color of people around me, I missed my stop. One day it snowed, and as I walked through the Boston Public Garden, I was moved to tears by the sight of individual snowflakes drifting with the wind. In forests, on airplanes, in crowds, and at dinner, it was a wondrous year of visual firsts. But listen to this. Since then, though, the wonder has faded. The rush of feeling is gone." I just wonder, for us who are in Christ, And maybe we have been for such a long time that the newness has rubbed off. The firsts have sunk into the past. And the freshness of new eyes, seeing the beauty of Christ, the forgiveness that comes in salvation, the gift of the church, the life that is in Him and only in Him, has maybe been replaced by the ho-hum, the normal, the boring, the uneventful days of doing the usual on just another Sunday. Did any of you wake up this morning to stare at your mother or your spouse or your children and just thank God? Did any of you grab anything and say, "And that's purple?" Did you look outside to see the beauty of the day? Did you sit motionless for a while, stunned by the grandeur of another morning? Did you in your heart anticipate coming here and just hearing the reading of the Word of God and take pleasure in the pleasure of prayer and take in for a moment the wonder of worship before you even stepped in the doors? Did you reflect just a moment on the goodness of the Lord and the greatness of His act of grace and the wisdom of the church that He made just for us? Did you look around in faith and love at those who also call on His name this morning? Or on too many Sundays, even like me, is this just another Sunday? Maybe we who are in Christ do need a new set of eyes. Maybe we need to slip on some new glasses, contacts, get a new vision to see the riches and the hope and the power of the Lord. Maybe we need a better way to see in faith and love and grace, to see things we've seen millions of times before, but now in a brand new way, as if we could actually see the color of God's grace and be amazed at it all over again and just sit in silence and wonder. Has your wonder faded? Is the rush of feeling gone for you too? May the eyes of our hearts truly be enlightened again today so that we can really, truly see. Let's stand and sing. Come if you need to.